from the international headquarters, McNeil headquarters in Baja Tustin. Here's Mark McNeil.
To talk about the third in the series of supply and demand, this one deals with equilibrium. We've done demand, we've done a separate video on supply, and now it's time to put them together. So, equilibrium means at rest, it means no tendency for change. It means all the forces that are balanced in these markets, operating in these markets, are balanced against each other so that we have stability. It's automatic and it harmonizes the opposed intentions of producers and consumers. Producers want high prices, consumers want low prices. They have opposed intentions. So we have over here the demand business with consumers saying, oh, if the price is high, we don't want to buy many of them. But if the price is low, look how many we want to buy. And if the price is $10, we want to buy that much. Over here we have suppliers based on their costs and technology and all that stuff, saying, well, you know, if the price is nice and high, like $20, oh, look at what we're going to supply, but if the price is only like $4, forget it. We're only going to supply. But at 10, we'll supply 100. Now, can those two groups ever get together in harmony? And the answer is absolutely. Suppliers bring their supply curves to market. Demand, consumers bring their demand curves to market. Suppliers bring the supply. Demand is demand. And they produce an interaction between buyers and sellers. And the definition of a market is any process by which buyers and sellers interact with each other, make exchanges with each other. So, and look at this. There is one price, $10, and only one, that harmonizes the opposed intentions of producers and consumers. And at that price, there will be equilibrium. And an equilibrium quantity is where quantity supplied equals quantity demanded. And sure enough, 100 in both cases. Now, can we be assured that markets will find this? And the answer is yes. Gerard Dubrow at UC Berkeley won a Nobel Prize for demonstrating this mathematically. I will attempt to demonstrate it verbally and wait for the prize to come, for the Nobel Prize Committee to call. So, what if the price is above $10? Well, it's not an equilibrium price, and will there be forces that will push the price down to equilibrium? At $10, it turns out that the quantity that sellers want to offer for sale is that quantity. But the quantity that people want to buy is shown by this point. It's right there on the demand curve. They only want to buy that quantity. So the quantity demanded will be small relative to the quantity that producers or sellers bring to the market. And when they get to the market, look, the quantity supplied exceeds the quantity demanded. That means this is not, we'll say this is $17, is not an equilibrium price. And in a free market where buyers and sellers are permitted to make any exchange that is mutually beneficial to both of them, then what's going to happen is this price, the sellers, rather than be stuck with the surplus, will start lowering their price. And as they lower the price, more buyers are interested in buying. And so, as the price goes down, 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 this gap between the quantity supplied and the quantity demanded starts to narrow and decrease. So that at $12, for instance, this is the quantity supplied, and that would be the quantity demanded. And now this gap between the two is only that wide, but there's still downward pressure on prices. And this downward pressure ends at equilibrium. So that's why a price above equilibrium creates a surplus and downward pressure on prices. A surplus is defined as a price at which the quantity supplied is greater than the quantity demanded. That's the definition of a surplus. And in a free market, the surplus pushes price down to equilibrium. What if the price is $8 for some reason? Well, if the price is $8 for some reason, at $8, I'll keep the green here, at $8, you can see that this point on the demand curve says that's going to be the quantity demanded, but at $8, this is going to be the quantity supply. And so this gap between the two, which I should show on this horizontal axis, because surpluses and shortages are measured along the horizontal axis as the difference between quantity supplied and quantity demanded. So there would be that much of a shortage. And it turns out that when there are this many people after it, I'll change that to demand because we're looking at this. if there are this many people after it, some of them are willing to pay more than $8 to get it, and they'll start bidding the price up. Not only that, suppliers, when the price starts going up, they're willing to sell a larger quantity than before. And as the price goes up, this gap between quantity supplied and quantity demanded narrows. So now, at, we'll say, $9.50 or something, then the gap is only that wide. And it still puts upward pressure on price until we get to equilibrium. So we measure a surpluses or shortages along the horizontal axis. It's the gap between quantity supplied and quantity demanded, expressed in the as a quantity. Okay. Now, if the price is P2, then that will create quantity supply greater than quantity demanded. There's the surplus and downward pressure on price until we get to equilibrium. If there is a price below equilibrium at P1, that will be the quantity demanded. That's the quantity supplied. Upward prices until we get to equilibrium. So the adjustment mechanism is that a price other than equilibrium either creates a surplus or a shortage, and that moves the price toward equilibrium. That's the question of how markets find equilibrium automatically. And those are the forces that drive it to it. The next issue we're going to deal with is, what if you have a market that is in equilibrium? There's the equilibrium price and equilibrium quantity. We're assuming that everything besides price that affects producers' decisions is held constant. Everything besides price that affects consumers' decisions are held constant. And how long does everything remain constant in a market in real life? And the answer is, I don't know, nanoseconds maybe. So our next issue is, what happens if one of these other things changes? One of these things that is held constant changes. Well, we know that this list of things that change the demand curve is in times past, really good beer existed. Income, tastes, and preferences, related goods, number of buyers, and consumer expectations. So if one of those changes, then the demand will shift. So let's have income change, and it's a normal good. Well, when income increases, at every price, the quantity that consumers want to buy is now larger. So this would shift the demand curve to D2. Well, it turns out that this demand curve doesn't exist anymore. That's the one before the income change. And the price P1 is no longer in equilibrium. At price P1, we now have quantity demanded larger than quantity supplied, and there would be this much of a shortage. So that shortage pushes price up until we get to our new equilibrium at a higher price, P2, so price goes up. And quantity will be Q2, so that is a larger quantity as well, because we start at zero. This is a number line that goes to the right. So the quantity is going to go up as well. There will be more sold each week in our market because of this increase in income. So that's how we find a new equilibrium if there's a change in demand. What if there's a change in supply? What causes a change in supply? Really tough schools eat their students. So resource prices, technology, number of sellers eat expectations, their students, taxes and subsidies. So what if there's a tax placed on this good? Well, that would shift the supply curve. That is a per unit tax. It's not an income tax. It's a tax on the sale of the good. And what that does is it raises the seller's costs, and it would shift the supply curve to S(T) for tax. Really, it shifts it vertically by the amount of the tax. And sure enough, as soon as that curve shifts, this is no longer the supply curve in the market, and P1 is no longer in equilibrium. At this price, this is the quantity demanded off the demand curve, that's the quantity supplied off the supply curve, and this gap between the two is a shortage, and that's the mechanism that pushes price up to the new equilibrium at price P2, so price goes up, and the quantity sold in this market is going to decrease to Q2. So that's the adjustment process when demand changes or supply changes. We move to a new equilibrium price and a new equilibrium quantity. Now the question is, what if both supply and demand shift together at the same time? Then that's one more degree of complication, but it's not a particularly big one. And the best way to look at it is supply, demand, equilibrium price, equilibrium quantity. This is the best way to do it, I think. So let's say you want demand to increase or decrease. Pick.
Increase.
Great. So demand increases because There's a favorable change in tastes and preferences, or the price of a substitute goes up. It could be anything. So here's D2, it's the new demand curve. Now, this by itself would cause us to move from this equilibrium that I'm going to call A to this equilibrium that I'm going to call B. So this shift right in the demand curve would cause the price to increase and the equilibrium quantity to increase as well. But that's not all that happens. There's a supply shift as well, because we have to have two shifts. That's the example I'm doing. And so, does supply increase or decrease? Pick.
Decrease.
Decrease. So supply decreases. Decrease in supply is a shift left. So there's our S2. And that will move us to the new, to this equilibrium that I'm going to call C. And C, so the supply decreases. Why does supply decrease in this case? What was it? Was it a tax? No. Supply decreases. Let's say it's a tax. Supply decreases. Demand increased because, what did we say? Income, taste, and preferences. I don't remember what the reason was.
Preferences.
Okay. Now, how does equilibrium C compare to equilibrium B in terms of price? Well, the price is going up, and the quantity is going? Oh, quantity is going to decrease compared to B. So overall, can we say, that demand, supply decreases because of a tax, demand increases because of preferences. Equilibrium price, both forces are pushing price up, so price is definitely going to go up. But one of these shifts wants to increase the equilibrium quantity, the other wants to decrease the equilibrium quantity. On balance, is the quantity going to increase, decrease, remain the same? And the answer is, unless we know which is the stronger force, we can't tell. So that will be indeterminate. And I use a question mark to show indeterminate. And if it helps you, so the rule is that if there are two shifts, either the equilibrium price or the equilibrium quantity will be indeterminate, because there will be forces pushing in both directions, either in the price or the quantity. And some students showed me this once. I think it's useful. All of these are decreases in demand, and all of these, I'm sorry, increases in demand, all of these are decreases in supply. It's just some are bigger shifts and some are smaller shifts. But any of these intersections would be possible new intersections. All of them are potentially new equilibria. So it's just the way I do it initially, that it's this one right here. But maybe you can see it. Every one, if you were to look at every one of these equilibrium, the price is going to be higher. But some of these equilibrium quantities, the quantities are higher, some are lower, and some of them are just the same as before. And that's why it's indeterminate. So that's equilibrium. Free markets. The last video, which I'm going to do in just, which is really video number four, it has to do with legally imposed prices. Those deal with ceilings and floors. These are legal maximum and minimum prices, and that's the last in this series of markets videos, unless I do a cleanup one, but I'm not that ambitious at the moment. Thank you very much.